Today I thought we'd talk about internet standards, and in particularly the request for comment.
The famous RFCs that we see referred here and there.
Yeah, so they started out exactly what they said on the tin, as a request for comment. So the very first one, RFC number one, was by Steve Crocker, who was one of the very early movers in the internet at UCLA, and he published that on the 7th of April 1969 as RFC 1, and it really was a request for comments. It was like, we're going to try doing these things.
What do you think, guys?
Exactly that. And so he sent it around to a few people saying, here's a request for comments. Have you got any comments on this? And the name kind of stuck. You know, pretty much all the internet standards, well, actually all the internet standards have now got RFCs behind them. So TCP and IP, they're RFC 793 and 791. And there's a couple of other ones around there. They grew fairly slowly because there weren't very many standards to publish in the early days, but they're going to get quite a way now.
So how does it work when one of these is published? How do the comments come in that have been requested, if
right.
you like?
Well, I don't know how they worked originally back in the early days, but nowadays you publish an RFC draft and you say, here's a draft and this is what I want to standardize, or some of them are informational, some of them are standards like TCP IP or RFC 822. I spent a lot of time with, that's the internet mail standard, and 821, which is SMTP. So some of them are just like that they define a standard. Some of them are sort of, these are best practices, or this is kind of what we got. There's quite a number of them, and I have to say I've contributed to this list that are just humorous and often posted on the 1st of April or something like that. So I've actually got three with my name as author. Two of them are pretty obscure now. They were early days stuff to do with X25 and TCP, and another one to do with network time over X25, which nobody does anymore. But perhaps my most famous one is RFC 1606, which was an April the 1st one. There's a little bit of history behind it. So at the time, we were running out of IP addresses, something that we're still doing to this very day. And this was back in 1990-something or other, this was. There's this big crunch coming up that we're going to run out of IP addresses any time now. It's 1994, we're still not run out, and there's lots of reasons behind that. And they were discussing IPv6, which is, you know, this new version of internet protocol that hasn't exactly taken the world by storm, but it's sort of gradually encroaching. And there's a lot of discussions. I think there were about six proposals at the time that were internet drafts and would become RFCs. And they'd all got various suggestions about it. So you probably know IP version 4 has a 32-bit addressing. So that means there's 4 billion possible places that you can address. And that seems a bit limited, you know, given there's, 8 or 9 billion people on the planet. If you want to give them each a internet address, you can't actually do it. But we get around that with NATs and things like that. So at the time, we were discussing what the IPv6 addressing should be, and there were various proposals. There's 64-bit, I think there's 60-bit. There's various other things. Usually it was in powers of two, because they fit into words quite easily. And there were one or two that were looking at 128 bit things. And at the time I wrote a short article, which wasn't actually published anywhere. I just posted it on Usenet, I think, on one of the group's TCP discussions. And instead of saying, no, this is silly, we should think ahead and let's not go crazy, let's fix this once and for all, that was sort of my argument. Lots of other people were arguing the same thing. So I thought I could write a sort of paper saying, no, we should go for 128 bits, because that's going to be far more addresses than we ever need. Because the original ARPANET started out with, I think, 256 addresses. They thought that would be plenty. That would be all the machines you'd ever need. And then they realised it wasn't. And then they went for 32 bits and said, 4 billion addresses, that's going to be more than we'll ever need. And then we came to E6 and they said, well, 64 bits, that's going to be more than we'll ever need. And so I wrote a rather spoof paper, which I called The Demise of IP Version 9 originally, but it got published as a historical perspective on the usage of IP Version 9. And it was supposed to be a sort of a 22nd century look back at why IP version 9 was having to be retired because it didn't have a big enough address space. So I published this out as a sort of tongue-in-cheek article and said, the serious point about it was, let's not make another mistake and go with just a small address space.
What's V6? Is it 64?
It's 128 bits. So there should be plenty to go around for that. So that was a good thing, anyway. But anyway, I published this out on the network. I think it was sort of February or March time, about now, I guess, just as a humorous thing. And I published a number of similar tongue-in-cheek articles that nobody took seriously, luckily. But this one was picked up by John Postell, who was the RFC editor at the time, a really lovely guy who edited all the RFCs up until his unfortunate, untimely demise. I only met him once. He lived on the west coast of America. Anyway, he sent me a quick email in response to this and said, found it quite amusing or something. Could we just publish an RFC? I said, I guess you could. What do I need to do to do that? He said, it's all done, taken care of. And duly on the 1st of April, it came out as this IP version 9. Now, the odd thing about it is that when people are looking for serious systems, like universities go out for tender to for a networking thing, they often sort of go through all the RFCs and say, which ones are to do with TCP, which ones are to do with IP? We'll make a tick list and say they should adhere to all these standards. And they often come across mine and say, IP version 9, we should definitely adhere to that standard. And so I've had many queries over the years since it was published saying, can I get an implementation of this IP version 9? Say, have you actually read the RFC? Because it's probably not something you want to...
So some unwitting system implementer has been told your proposal must adhere to all these standards.
All these have got IP in their title, so you should adhere to them all. We all know RFCs are standards, but there's actually about 30 or 40 humorous RFCs that you should not adhere to. I mean, there's one that predates mine, RFC 1149, which is the transmission of IP datagrams over avian carriers. So this is how to transmit TCP IP over pigeons. And there has been actually an implementation of that where you print out the packet, you attach it to the foot of a pigeon, you send it off, you catch it in the loft, you then type back in. If we go back to one of your recent ones about pings and trace routes, they actually did a ping thing with this. The ping time was several hours or whatever.
I was going to say, if you were lucky.
Yeah. That one has also been cited in proposals saying we should adhere to all the RFCs, and 1149 seems to be to do with IP too, so I have to get that.
I'd like to see that implemented wide scale. It'd be like Harry Potter or something.
I think there's been an update to it to actually improve the performance of it. What people do with their spare time is quite weird.
What do you have to do to make an RFC?
Unless you're doing one of these humorous ones, usually you form a group and you get together, particularly if it's something that's crucial, like internet mail or TCP IP or IPv6. IPv6, they deliberated about for several years before they came up with... They picked the one version that they were going to go with and went for. So usually you form a group, you form a working group, you publish drafts, people comment on the drafts, you revise the drafts, people comment on those, they argue about them, they add features. A bit like any other standardisation.
Where does the numbering come from, though? Is there someone that hands out a number for you?
Yeah, normally you just get the next number in the sequence. So now, a few of them you do get special numbers. So when they revised RFC 822, which is the Internet Mail Standard, was coming, they were in the 2000s at the time, and they waited to 2822, so it got 2822. I think it's been revised again, or they're always tinkering, adding little bits on to them. Sometimes they replace the entire standard and they say it's now been deprecated and it's been replaced by this one. So in that case, you know, RFC 822 was replaced with 2822, which was nice and memorable.
Sounds like it's crying out for a blockchain solution.
Oh, yeah. Yes, could well be. I don't know that probably somebody has considered that. Who knows?
Now, what if there was a secret mathematical relationship between P and Q? Would that change anything? What if P was actually equal to some multiple of Q, like this? Now, it would be very difficult to prove that.
With different time to lives, you can find out every hop on your journey. Fair enough.